earlier class we saw the implementation of KKT, and we saw also that it can detect instabilities. In some cases it can detect nonlinearity, in some cases it cannot, and you will have to use it in admittance format if the real part of the impedance goes to the negative side. Otherwise, if you use it in the impedance format and try the transformation, you would get mirror image like result. Another choice for KKT validation is to use the measurement model approach, where we try fitting this to a model with n number of white elements or n number of Maxwell elements. There are multiple choices available, but in any of those, if you are able to fit it well, then we can say data is validated. If it does not fit well, we should make sure that we are doing the best in terms of fitting. After that, if the residuals are systematic, if the residuals are large, we know data has some problem. But that is easy to say that you fit it with 1, 2, 3 and so on, right? It takes time to do that. So what I want to show you today is a software which is called Linear KKT, okay, and illustrate how it's can be used, okay. And once that is completed, we will go to analysis using equivalent circuits. So the Linear KKT software, it is actually available for download in public, okay, except that it is not easy to find the link. Search for it, you won't find it, at least in the first page of the Google. This is in University of Twente in Netherlands. So it's https U20 Netherlands. EN is for English, TNW is Faculty of Science and Technology in their language, it's short for that, and it gives in the list of publications and downloads. This it's available in public, so obviously you can download and use it. Anybody else can also download and use it, right? So if you go there, just to give you a screenshot of that, you would see variety of programs and files on the left side. You scroll down, you will see kkwindows.zip, that is Linear KKT. And there is another program called equivalent circuit for DAS, that is also something that you can use for circuit fitting for analysis. It is not meant for KKT analysis, it is meant for what we are going to see subsequently. It is inorganic material science. So this is similar to the measurement model that you have discussed before, okay, except that we want to find R1, C1, R2, C2 and so on, and see what gives us the best fit. Here there is an additional constraint. When you look at the circuit, you can calculate the time constant for each of these white element. This entire thing in the box is called white element. It has one capacitor and one resistor, okay. The time constant is RC, meaning product of R and C. Now the data is acquired in a frequency range, fixed frequency range, and based on that, you can calculate the time constants. Inverse of the frequency will give you the time, okay. So what happens is, we can say per decade of frequency, 10 power minus 3 to 10 power minus 2, 10 power minus 2 to 10 power minus 1, I would choose 5 time constants, 7 time constants, and then you are going to fix C1 R1 product. We do not know the individual values of C1 and R1, C2 and R2, but you can fix the time constants and then find the value of R and C by fitting it to the data. What happens is, the equation become linear equations. So you basically have to get a matrix, invert the matrix and get the results. So it is going to be Ax equal to b, in which case initial values are not important. You do not really need initial values to solve this, okay, which means it is going to be fast. You do not have to go through iterations and guess whether the initial values that you chose are correct or not. And in circuit fitting, normally you will need to choose the initial values correctly, okay. That examples we will see when we go to the next session. So the equations to find R and C are linear. Actually, equations to find one of this is linear. Once you know the R value, you know the tau value, therefore you can find the C value. So this method is not linearization of the integrations that you have seen before. It does not take this equation and linearize it. So just keep in mind that this is not linearization of those equations. It is more of, you have got linear set of equations to perform measurement model analysis, which is equivalent to doing the KKT. I want to show you some examples with simple data and with little more complex data. Okay. So, I want to show you some example where you have data like this. I want to show you some example where you have data like this. Okay. Interface looks like this. First thing you need to do is to make sure that the data properties or file properties, which is basically data settings. In this case, I do not have any column header. So, few settings you will have to select. 0 number of headers, this I leave it as empty, this I leave it as empty. Impedance, it is given as Z real and Z imaginary, given as Z prime and Z double prime. Space delimited data set, so I am going to look at the data set which looks like this, space delimited, frequencies, real and imaginary part. Weight factor, you can tell that the standard deviation or how much weightage you have to give for each data point. Sometimes you may have more confidence in the high frequency data and less confidence in the low frequency data, in which case you can say give more importance to the high frequency data and see if that fits well. Normally we leave it as internal weight factor, which is by default 1, but if you have a better idea of which data has more confidence and which data you have less confidence, you can give that also. This is not relevant, we leave it as it is. If this number of headers is more in your actual data, you will have to give that value. Okay. So, we are going to take that. I will take one example. You can see this is showing you two loops here, and you can go to the transform settings. We want to transform this in impedance mode. You can leave this checked. If necessary, it will add a capacitor or inductor. It works only in the complex test. It does not work for whatever reason. The software is not geared towards making this. The tau value is time constant per decade. Default value is 7. You can leave it as it is. This you do not need to touch. It will look at the data and calculate this. You do not usually need to touch this. You can say okay. If you want to change something, it is probably this tau value per decade, you can increase or decrease that. You can try and see what the results are. You will have to use the admittance mode when your data is on the other side. Okay. So, if you say do KK transform, it will do the transform and tell you the residuals, how they are as a function of frequency. Frequency is from 1 millihertz to 100 kilohertz here, and of course, this is synthesized data, so it is 0, it fits exactly. And you see now black and red. This shows that the data, transformed data and the original data are overlapping exactly, which is what you would expect for a clean data like this. Now, I want to show you another set of data. Okay. In this, the data is given with impedance in the format of real and minus imaginary. I can go here and source it differently, or I can just say here that okay, I have given it wrongly, just correct this. Now, this is how the data looks, it is a synthesized data again. And let us say that I forgot to change this from impedance to admittance mode, and I do the transform, it is ugly. Residuals are very large, and they are not random, they are systematic. The red and blue, one of them represents the real and one of them represents the residuals in the imaginary.
So, how will you define that up to high? We are talking about sometimes we say that it will fit with the high frequency, sometimes it will fit with the low frequency.
Not sometimes. I have better confidence in the high frequency data. So, in the low frequency data, if it does not fit, I am not very worried, because anyway, I do not have confidence in the data. One way is to remove that low frequency data and analyze. Another way is to give weight factors, that is give more importance and less importance to, more importance to some points, less importance to some points. That is what you can define. But normally we go with equal importance to everything, but the choice is available.
So, first we go with the low frequency, I mean it will give us more confidence?
No, no. If you have some reason to believe that part of your data has more confidence than another part of the data, you can give a list, a column with weight factors, give 100% importance to this, 50% importance to this, etc. for each data point, and this can handle it. What it means is, let me go back to the presentation and write there. What it means is, I have a list of data point, right? Frequency, Z real, Z imaginary. I can add one more column called weight factor. And I can say this is data point 1, this is some number, this is data point 2, this is some number. So, when it calculates the residuals, it is going to calculate for real part at this frequency. I am going to write it as Z real model minus Z real experiment by Z real model, that is one choice, and I can multiply by the weight factor. Then when I plot it, let us say this is how it comes, when I do not give any weight factor it is unity. I may say this weight, this data I am not giving that much weight factor, this data I am giving more weight. So, this will probably shrink to a level. So, if you give 1 here, 0.5 here, 0.1 here, then that is going to be multiplied by the weight factor. It is more to tell you that these options are available, but in order to use them, you will have to come with some justification. Normally you will say all data are of equal confidence, you have equal confidence in all of them, or are equally likely to be good. Another way, a better way, but it is a more time consuming method, is to replicate the experiments, do it few number of times, get the average, get the standard deviation, inverse of the standard deviation, you can use it as a weight factor. Inverse of a standard deviation or variance. If it varies a lot, you have poor confidence in it. If it does not vary at all, you have higher confidence in it, correct. But then you have to decide how many experiments you have to repeat, and if you have more repeats, your standard deviation will become less as long as the data is repeatable. Right? Now, let us see if we can clear this. And of course, it tries to model, it is not able to model the high frequency, and up to this level it is okay. Beyond this it is not modeling it well, and we expect that if I do this in the admittance mode, it will work correctly, and of course, it goes back to 0 residuals and a very good fit. So, this is a good quality data, it is a synthesized data. If I take experimental data, it will have some noise if I go to low enough frequencies. But we have taken data in our lab, and we have got data where it goes to the left side. We have taken data where it goes to the left side like this, sometimes like this, and of course, it will fit only if you use admittance format. The point that I want to make here is this software is relatively easy to use. It is free. You can use it easily, validate your data. Quickly, you can save the transformed and original data. So, if you go here, yeah. Okay, here is the thing. The one which comes on the left side, right, that can be acquired only in potential static mode. The data which comes here, the data which comes either like this or like this or with whatever, you can have something like this, whichever comes to the left side of this complex plane, you can get it in potential static mode, you would not be able to get it in galvanostatic mode. You would not be able to get it, meaning it will not be stable under galvanostatic mode. Usually you get data like this or something like this with inductive loop, with capacitive loop. This you may get it while you are operating under potential static mode, but that will also be stable under galvanostatic mode. Okay. So, it will not matter whether you are transferring it in the admittance form or in the impedance form. Typically you get data in the impedance form, you try KKT in impedance form, it works, you are fine. Even though you acquire the data under potential static mode, because the data is coming from a system that is stable under potential static as well as galvanostatic mode, you won't have any issue if it transforms the data in the impedance format. So, how do I know that the data that comes on the left side will not be stable under potential static mode? I am making a claim here, hold for some time, a few days, we will come with examples and show you this is an example system. Here the data will show that the real part of the impedance will come to the negative side, and here it is not stable under galvanostatic mode because of this reason. No, I do not want to jump from here to that part and then come back here. So, just to show in the screenshots, first you need to check the data setting so that your data format is given here, whatever that values are, whether it is number of headers 1, number of lines 0. You can give multiple data sets here, but usually we use one data set for this. You can give multiple spectra, but you have to choose the format correctly and give this. And you normally need to adjust either it is in the impedance or in the admittance, and tau per decade is what you may need to change. The default value of 7 usually works well. Then you can get the transform data.